Good evening. I'll try that again. Good evening. Welcome to Emporia State University. My name is Jason Brooks. I'm the Assistant Dean of Students for Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion, and welcome to our first Social Justice and Equity Lecture. Tonight, we have such a special treat for us. This is the third time that Mr. Tim Wise has been here, but I would rather give you his formal credentials instead of me talking here for the next 3 to 4 minutes. So, Tim Wise, whom scholar and philosopher Cornel West calls a vanilla brother in the tradition of abolitionist John Brown, is among the nation's most prominent anti-racist educators. He has spent the past 25 years speaking to audiences in all 50 states, on over 1,000 colleges and high school campuses, at hundreds of professional and academic conferences, and to community groups across the nation. He has also lectured internationally in Canada, Bermuda, and has trained corporate, government, law enforcement, and medical industry professionals on methods for dismantling racism and their institutions. He is one of 5 persons, including President Obama, interviewed for a video exhibition on race relations in America, featured at the newly opened National Museum of African American History and Culture in Washington, D.C. Additionally, his media presence includes dozens of appearances on CNN, MSNBC, and NPR, featured interviews on ABC's 2020 and CBS's 48 Hours. He has contributed chapters to over 25 additional books, and his writings are taught in college campuses across the nation. His essays have appeared in the Huffington Post and The Root, which recently named Tim Wise as one of the 8 wokest white people we know. Can we put our hands together and give Mr. Tim Wise a warm Emporia, Kansas welcome?
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you. Thanks. Thank you. Not a bad turnout. Clearly, extra credit still counts for something in higher education. That's all right. I know the deal. I was a college student once, you know. I understand the value of academic bribery. I get it. I appreciate the opportunity to talk with you again. This is, I believe it's the third time I've been here. I know the first time was in 1998. So 19 years later, here we are again. I was much younger then. Some of you were not even alive yet. I need not be reminded of that. I'm perfectly aware of it, and it makes me feel terrible and much, much older than I probably should feel. A lot has happened in that 19 years. I suppose one could suggest that a lot has happened in the last 19 days. So, yeah, I'm not sure it's clap-worthy, but some shit happened. That's for sure. you know, it's funny. We booked this event quite a ways back, several months. You know, it's been on the calendar. And at the time, my talk was sort of, I think it had been marketed, at least to me, I was told, that it was supposed to be this rather generic talk that I give in a lot of different places about the problems of colorblindness and the problems of sort of this so-called post-racial politics that for the last 8 years we've sort of been locked into, this idea that we didn't really have to talk about race anymore because after all, you know, a black guy was president. Yeah, okay, so that was a long time ago. And now we clearly do not have that problem. We do not have the problem of color blindness or the problem of people assuming that race is no longer an issue. I certainly hope we are not continued to be locked in that particular mentality. So in the course of the several months since this speech was booked, some things happened that by necessity require me to give a very, very, very different, but I think much, much more fun speech this evening than the one that I was originally going to give. It's going to be more fun for me. I have no way of knowing how fun it is going to be for you, but good thing is I get paid either way and the lights are up, so if you get up to leave, I'm going to notice it's tacky. I'll probably call it out. It's just how I am. It's been a long day. So you might just want to hang out for like an hour, hour and a half of your life. You're never going to get it back, but I'll try to make it not hurt too much. We are, I think it is, you know, relatively fair to say, at both a very important but also potentially very dangerous point in our nation's history. That might be an understatement of somewhat biblical proportions for some of us, but there it is in any event. And I'm glad to be able to come and maybe offer some clarity as to what is happening in our country right now, why it's happening, and how we might collectively begin to move forward. I want to start in that process by referring to some folks quite a bit more wisdom-filled than I, and specifically people of color, who I think for those of us who are white and do race relations work, anti-racism work, civil rights work, it's particularly important for us to acknowledge that in almost every case, the source, at least the original initial source of whatever wisdom we happen to have, is typically black and brown, right? I'm a relatively smart guy. My mom would love for you to think that I'm really brilliant because that's how mothers are and they like to brag on their kids. But the truth is that most of the wisdom when it comes to the issue of race and racism in this country comes from black and brown people. Sometimes those of us who are white are employed as translators of black and brown wisdom for other white people because from what we can gather, we have an easier time hearing it from one of our own. But that doesn't change the fact that the source of the wisdom is black and brown. I want to say that up front so that, you know, you will know that if you're really interested in these issues, it's fine to come to my talk. It's great to buy my books. I certainly hope you will. It's fine to read my articles and follow my Twitter feed. Well, that might not be a good idea, actually, but but I've been usurped in terms of obnoxiousness lately on Twitter, and so therefore I'm not so worried about it. One always looks better in relation to one's adversaries, I suppose. But really, we need those of us who are white to be willing to go and to really read the words of, listen to the words of people of color when they talk about race. It's fine to come to this talk. The question is, are we really listening when people of color say the same things? So I want to start off by quoting a couple such persons who I think have really put in perspective what the dilemma is that faces us and how we might want to begin to understand it. First, James Baldwin. Possibly, in fact, that's not even accurate. Inarguably, the finest writer ever to sit pen to paper, or typewriter, as it was in his day, to paper. He said, and he was referring specifically, of course, to white America, he said, people who imagine that history flatters them, as it does indeed since they wrote it, are impaled on their history like a butterfly on a pin, and they become incapable of seeing or changing themselves or the world. This is where it appears to me, Baldwin continued, this is where it appears to me most white Americans find themselves impaled. They are dimly or vividly aware that the history they have fed themselves is mainly a lie, but they do not know how to be released from it, and they suffer enormously from the resulting personal incoherence. Later on in the same volume, he writes in much shorter form, but essentially the same thought, just a bit shorter, more truncated. He says, these innocent people, and he was referring again to white Americans in only the most ironic sense of the word innocent. He said, these innocent people are trapped in a history they do not understand. And until they understand it, they cannot be released from it. I want you to hold that thought for a second, and then let me refer you to someone else whose wisdom was shared with me many years after I read those words from Baldwin. It was the words of Randall Robinson, the founder of Trans Africa, one of our nation's anti-apartheid activists in the 1980s, a human rights advocate for many years. He has since become an expat of this country, moving with his wife to St. Kitts, her native home. Wrote a book about leaving America, actually, called Quitting America, which explained his decision as a black man in this country to give up on the country of his birth and rearing. It's a brilliant book, very interesting, very challenging book. He also wrote a book called The Debt, which looks at the moral and practical case for reparations to those who were the descendants of enslaved persons, also a brilliant and challenging book. I was at a conference with Robinson at one point many years ago, and he was speaking before me, and he got up and he made this statement, which again, very basic statement, sort of along the lines of what Baldwin was saying, truncated though, much shorter, much less poetic than Baldwin. That's no criticism of Randall Robinson. It's just to say that nobody speaks quite like Baldwin, and certainly nobody writes like him. So Randall Robinson gets up and he says, you know, if you don't understand the predicate, if you don't understand the precursor, if you don't understand what came before, nothing that you see today will make any sense to you, particularly when it comes to the issue of race and racial inequality, right? That's a rather basic statement, but it's really quite profound. If you don't understand what happened yesterday, metaphorically speaking, or last year, or 10 years ago, or 50, or 100, it's very hard for you to look at what's going on this week and understand it fully, because The past and the present are so inextricably connected. And I was thinking about that in the wake of this election, and I wanted to sort of put this out there up front. I'm not going to talk just about the election. There's so much more to talk about, but I did want to sort of mention this with regard to Robinson's admonition about understanding the predicate, what came before, understanding history and its relation to the present. The reason it's so important is because too often when we talk about race and racism, white Americans in particular are very quick, are we not, to tell people of color in particular who talk about the past and the weight of the past and the history of the past and the impact of the past, we are extraordinarily quick to look at them and say, why do you have to bring that up? That was a long time ago. Why can't we move on? Why can't we get over it? Now this, I beg to remind you, is precious coming from white people. Because there is nobody on this earth that loves the past more than white Americans. We absolutely adore it. We worship it. That's why the Tea Party said they wanted their country back. Back is a directional reference. And it does not point to the future. Right? That's why some folks made pretty little hats that said, make America great again. Like it used to be. Back when Opie would go to the fishing hole with Pa. And then they'd go back to Aunt B's house and have cookies. Right? Make America great again. See, that's coming from people who think the past was this wonderful, splendid place, ignoring how unsplendid it was for millions of their countrymen and countrywomen. So white folks love the past. We just like the pretty part for us. We just like the part that makes us feel special, the part that makes us feel better, the part that makes us feel like our nation is the greatest nation ever struck off from the forehead of God Almighty. We just don't want to be burdened with the less pretty parts, the parts that folks of color occasionally decide they want to remind us of. So it isn't that we don't love the past. I mean, July 4th celebrations, Independence Day parades, I mean, that's the past, right? That's about some old shit, right? That breaking away from the British, we didn't do that last Wednesday. That happened a really long time ago, right? And we're setting off fireworks, though, every year, eating hot dogs, apple pie, wearing red, white, and blue, right? Because we love the past. So let's just be real. It isn't the past we have a problem with. It's just the reality, the truth, the complexity of the past. But if you want to understand what's going on today, you have to understand the past. If you want to know why Donald Trump is president right now, there is one primary reason, and it has nothing to do with any of us in this room or politics in 2016, 2017. He is president because in 1787, a group of men in Philadelphia created a system under the Constitution that decided that president should be chosen by the Electoral College. They set that system up. Because without that, Donald Trump is not president. He lost by 3 million votes. Make no mistake, not 3 million illegal votes. That is a lie, only one of many told in the last 3 weeks. And it will not be the last. I suspect there will be several more told on social media before I am done this evening. And so, he loses the popular vote by 3 million votes. But he's president because of the Electoral College, which then begs the question, why do we have that? Now, you've heard a lot about this since the election. A lot of folks have said, oh, you know, the reason was they were trying to protect against tyranny. Have y'all studied the Founding Fathers? You actually think they had a problem with tyranny? Right? Some of these folks own human beings. They were sort of chill with tyranny, right? They just didn't like King George's tyranny. It was just some folks, it was other folks' tyranny they didn't like. It wasn't some abstract love of liberty that motivated most of these men. That's not why we have an electoral college. You know why? The primary reason, one we don't like to discuss, is because the primary slaveholding capitals of the Republic, or the soon-to-be or only recently declared Republic, right, that was now fashioning a constitution, right? The primary slaveholding capitals, Virginia, South Carolina, places that were utterly dependent on enslaved labor for their wealth, went to Philadelphia and said, you know what, we can't have direct democracy, and we can't just have the vote based on population numbers in the abstract. Why? Because 40% of our population can't vote. Why? Because 40% of our population aren't even counted as human beings. Oh, well, they are, but 3/5 of a human being for the purpose of census enumeration. So if you've just discounted 40% of your population, right, by 40%, And then you're going to have elections based on the full enumeration of your census. You're going to be at a disadvantage, aren't you, relative to other states that get to count virtually everybody because they're not as dependent on slave labor, and therefore their populations are primarily quote-unquote free. So the slaveholding elite come and say, we got to have a system that rigs this a bit and gives us a bit more power than we otherwise would have. The Electoral College, in large part, is crafted as a response to that, which is to say the Electoral College is a vestige of institutional white supremacy, which is to say Donald Trump is president today because of a system of white supremacy crafted over 230 years ago. So if anyone's wondering why we still got to talk about slavery, there you have it. Even if it wasn't enough to talk about it because of the impact on black folks, like even if that wasn't relevant, right? Even if it like wasn't enough to say, wow, you know, maybe that has something to do with the fact that the typical white family has 15 times the net worth of the typical black family. Like even if that didn't matter, maybe this does. Even if it didn't matter that the Homestead Act gave 240 million acres of virtually free land to white folks in places like this state, right? At a time when people of color couldn't get in on any of that. Even if that didn't matter in the way that the past affects the present, maybe this will. Maybe the fact that the president can be selected by the decisions made by long dead racists will penetrate our consciousness and make us understand how the past affects the present, or as Randall Robinson would put it, how the predicate matters. Same is true with things we look around beyond the election. If you don't understand the history, for instance, of police interactions with the black community, then the uprising on behalf of police accountability and demands for police accountability from black activists in the Black Lives Matter movement will not make sense to you. They will seem outrageous to you if you don't know that history, right? Because to have people rising up, expressing anger with police, if police have always been the people that come to your neighborhood to get the cat out of the tree, right? Or give little Billy a ride around when he's 11 to show him what a gosh darn exciting career choice policing might be, right? It doesn't make sense if that's your experience with cops, right? To have people rising up and demanding accountability. But that isn't the black experience with law enforcement, period. And black people know it because that history is written on their social and cultural DNA in their history. But for those of us who are white, we have the luxury of not knowing that. Black folks don't. African Americans know that modern policing traces directly to slave patrols. That is the first example of policing in our country. Law enforcement, usually working class guys, set up by rich people to keep other working class black and brown folks in line, right? Sort of similar, isn't it? Because rich folks are never cops, just like rich folks are never soldiers, right? Rich folks get poor people and working class people to do their dirty work for them, right? And so you put some folks on a slave patrol to keep black folks in line, then later on it's cops who you have enforced the black codes, which were passed after slavery was abolished, to keep black folks in line. Then it's cops who are the ones enforce segregation to keep black folks in line. It's cops who pull protesters off of stools in the South during the sit-in movement to keep black folks in line. It's cops who enforce the war on drugs, which, I beg to remind you, is not a war on drugs. And this we know for a couple of reasons. Number one, the data is very clear. White folks use drugs, sell drugs, possess drugs every bit as often as black folks do. Contrary to stereotype, black folks do not use drugs more, they do not deal drugs more, they do not possess drugs more, but they are the ones who get arrested. Four times as likely to be arrested for weed than white folks, even though use of marijuana is roughly identical between these groups. But we also know that the war on drugs is not about drugs because I'm standing here. I'm going to give you a second to let that catch up with you. Right. If the war on drugs were about drugs, I don't really know who'd be giving this talk tonight. But I know it wouldn't be me. Because I don't think they let you Skype in the lecture from prison. And prison is where I would be if the war on drugs were about drugs. And I can tell you this now because the statute of limitations has expired. And they cannot touch me. But course, I wasn't suspected, wasn't detected, wasn't prosecuted, arrested, incarcerated, nor were very many white folks like myself who engaged in the same thing when we were in school or who engage in the same thing now all across this country. We got white folks becoming millionaires selling weed in Colorado right now and in Washington State and in Oregon where it's been legalized, selling the same product that young black and brown youth are still being busted for on the corner. They tell you that weed's been legalized, but that's not true. It's only been legalized if you got the money for a storefront and an occupational license. It's not legal. If I'm slinging it on the curb, same product, but I don't have the money for an occupational license and a tax ID number, I am going to jail, right? But white men are becoming millionaires selling the same product because daddy set them up in business, or they found an angel investor, you know, to put the money up. It's crazy what we've done with weed, too, by the way, y'all. I was in Oregon a couple months ago, and they don't let you buy and, like, take it to the hotel, so don't get ideas. Like, I wasn't, not that kind of thing. I'm just driving down the road, and I see they got, like bulletin boards for weed, right? Like, ads, big weed ads everywhere, weed ads. Like, ads that are like, come get your weed with essence of elderberry notes and shit. Like, what? Why do I need, like, essence of grapefruit in my weed? And it's like a wine and cheese shop, and they're like, what cheese do I pair with my weed? I don't want to pair any cheese with my weed. Cheetos maybe, but not cheese. It's like we have gentrified weed. White folks didn't just want to gentrify the neighborhood, we gentrified weed. It's crazy how that happened, but making millions of dollars while people of color continue to go to jail. So people of color know that's the history of law enforcement. Now, please don't misunderstand. I'm not saying that all police are horrible people or racist or mean or bigoted or brutal or any of that. I think most people are good people, whether they're in uniform, out of uniform, whatever. I think most folks are good folks. But here's the problem. The history of law enforcement vis-a-vis the black community is about the culture of policing. It's not about every cop. It's about the culture of law enforcement and the mentality that one has to bring to that job in metropolitan and urban areas. And if you don't have that mentality, they run your ass out. So there's a guy in Baltimore, you can read about him. He's done several interviews, written a lot about this. His name is Joe Crystal. And several years ago, this guy, here's a guy, white dude, right? Served in either Afghanistan or Iraq or maybe both. I don't know. He gets out of the Marines or the Army, whichever one it was, and he goes to Baltimore. He wants to be a cop. His parents were cops. They were both NYPD. All he's ever wanted to be was a police officer, right? So he goes and he goes through the cadet school and he graduates top of his cadet class. Everybody loves him. He makes detective within 2 years, really fast for a new person in a big city department like the Baltimore PD to become a detective that quickly, but he did because people thought he was really great, you know? And then one day, he goes out on a call, right, that there's apparently a guy they think is a drug user or drug dealer or whatever who the cops are chasing, and they see him toss like a bag in the bushes or whatever, and they continue to pursue him. They pursue him. He runs into some house to get away, like breaks into a house to get away. And I guess at some point, the woman who lived in that house or was staying in that house calls the cops and says, oh, my God, this guy broke in. He's in the backyard. Come get him. They realize it's the same guy. They go get him. So Joe goes on this call, and he's there when they arrest the guy. They bring him out. You know, they catch him. They bring him out. They put him in the van. They're driving him downtown. And he thinks, okay, you know, good. They caught the guy. No big deal. And then all of a sudden, he sees something real strange. This other cop shows up, and he's on the phone, right? And he's talking to somebody, and he's telling him to bring the van back with the guy in it, right? So come to find out, this guy that's on the phone who's telling him to bring the car back or the van back is the owner of the house that this guy happened to break into. So, you know, he really screwed up. He broke into a Baltimore police officer's house. Not the best move, right? And so this cop is pissed now. He broke into his house. It was his girlfriend or whatever who was in the house, who the guy scared. So, you know, this dude is pissed now. And they bring the van back. They get the guy out. Still haven't booked him yet. Bring him out with his cuffs on. Take him back to where they found him in the back of the house in the backyard. And they beat the crap out of him. And Joe, this white cop, right, hears it all. Hears what's going on, knows what's going on. They see him bring the guy out. He's all bloodied and beaten, clothes are torn. And he's horrified by this, right? He's like, what the hell? You can't just do that. This guy comes from a cop family. He knows good policing and bad policing. So he's horrified by it. He goes back. He calls his parents that night. He's like, what should I do? And his mom and dad are both like, you know what you have to do. You have to file a complaint. You got to turn these guys in. So he does. And all of a sudden he's told, you know, by his commanding officers, he might want to drop it. Doesn't want to do this. Right. They decide they're not going to pursue it. He goes to the DA. Brings it to the attention of local prosecutors. Right now, all of a sudden, the whole department turns on him, right? They call him a rat. They put dead rats on his car, right? They refuse to back him up on calls. Now, this is now putting his life in danger, right? He's getting calls to go out on real dangerous responses to criminal activity. He gets out there pursuing some criminal suspect, and there's nobody to back him up because these guys are setting him up to die. They don't care. They feel like he ratted them out, even though what they did was unconstitutional, immoral, completely criminal, but they would rather defend their own criminal activity than actually side with what's right and what's just. That's a culture of policing. They run him out. See, so it isn't about good cops, bad cops. It's about a system that maintains this kind of lock on people's behavior. And that's what people of color have experienced. But if you don't know that history, right, which most of us who are white, we don't. They haven't taught us that. And we haven't lived it, so we don't know it. And if you don't know that, and you haven't lived that, when folks scream Black Lives Matter, we get defensive. Well, what about us? Don't our lives matter? Why, all lives matter. I know, Precious. I know. Oh, I know they do. I know they do. I have a daughter who's 15 and another one who's 13. You don't have to tell me their lives matter. I'm fully aware. Help bring them into this world. So I'm real clear on how much their lives matter. Here's the difference. The police also know their lives matter and never question that. And the teachers know their lives matter and never question that. And the loan officers at the bank know their lives matter and they never question that. And the employers know their lives matter and will never question that. You just have to specify that which isn't recognized as true. You have to specify that which gets left out. You have to specify that which goes unsaid, not that which is obvious, right? That's what folks of color are trying to remind us, because we have a long history in white America of saying all but not meaning it. We said, did we not, or at least Thomas Jefferson did, that all men are created equal, endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights, among these life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. But when he said those things, he owned over 200 other human beings, so he clearly did not mean it. In the 1880s, when the first version of the Pledge of Allegiance was written, and it was updated in the 1920s and then all the way through to about 1954, every version, though, ended with that line, did it not? That we have liberty and justice for all. That's the last words of the pledge. But that was written in the 1880s, again in the 20s, and in 1954, all at a time when we didn't mean it. So when we insist all lives matter, but we have a history of not really believing our own hype and our own narrative and our own rhetoric, saying all even while we denigrate and marginalize the lives of millions, then we're going to have to forgive black folks for wanting to remind us of the thing that we keep forgetting and have been forgetting for a couple hundred years, see, without getting pissy about it, without getting defensive and upset about it. But again, if you don't know the history of how black life has been discounted in this country by law enforcement and a lot of other folks, then I suspect it won't make sense. So the past matters. And I started thinking about this, especially a few years ago, not so much as an academic or a scholar or an activist or educator or any of this stuff, but as a parent. Because when you're a parent, right, you're always sort of amazed by how your kids are learning new things and how they come to process new things. A lot of it happens so quickly you don't even, you know, notice that it happens. But sometimes there are these moments where the kids will ask you certain questions and you realize there's like learning going on. It's a really sort of amazing process, yes? And so one day I was driving my daughters to dance. They're both dancers, and they were in a dance company in downtown Nashville that's about 8 minutes drive on surface roads from the school they attend. And so this is a drive that we had made every day for a year, roughly. But on this particular day, I suspect, they finally, or one of the children, at that time 10 years old, or as the kids like to say, 10 and a half, you know, she decided to ask me a question that I'm sure had been on her mind before this, but this was the one day she decided to ask it. So we're at a red light about halfway to the studio, And the red light happens to be at an intersection that's in the middle of public housing in Nashville. So public housing development to my right, public housing development to my left, right? And Rachel, the 10-year-old, says, Daddy, why is it that this neighborhood is pretty much all black? That's a damn good question, right? I mean, that's a really good question, especially for a 10-year-old. That is a hell of a sociological inquiry right there. That is urban anthropology happening in the back seat, right? She's in like fifth grade or something, or fourth grade. I'm like, damn, all right, good question. Luckily, Daddy knows the answer, because this is what I do, right? If she had asked me how to do taxes, I don't know. TurboTax, you know? If she had asked me, like, how does electricity work, I'd have been like, I don't know. Google it, you know? We'll learn together. But because she asked this question, probably figuring that maybe I would know, I was ready, you know? Now, here's the thing I learned that day. I didn't know this, because I'm an only child, so I did not know that when an older sibling is in the presence of the younger sibling, at the moment where the younger sibling asks the parent a question, it is inevitably the case that the older sibling will attempt to answer the question as a way to show off to the parent how much they know. I did not know this was a thing until that day. So the younger child says, why is this neighborhood pretty much all black? And the older kid jumps in like, Dad's ready. Here comes my answer. I got like 8 minutes, 6 minutes, 5 minutes. I'm good. I can't do the PhD version, but I can give you the thumbnail sketch. And the older kid butts in and says, redlining, which is scary ass accurate for those of y'all that know what the word means. And for those who don't, you're about to. I was stunned. She said redlining. And I was like, what? How'd you know that? The younger one was like, I don't know what that means. I said, I don't think your sister does either, but that was a really good guess, right? So it turns out that our older daughter was onto something, right? There was this thing called redlining, which was a very common practice for decades, and it was perfectly legal until 1968 when the Fair Housing Act was passed. And even after that, it continued in sort of indirect ways. The best estimates we have today are that probably 2 to 3 million cases of race-based housing discrimination against people of color every year still happening, even with the law saying that that can't happen. But back before 1968, it was perfectly legal. Banks would take maps of neighborhoods, and they would put them up on the wall in the loan office, and they would take a red marker, and they would draw a line around the black community. And anybody who lived in the boundaries of that red line was not going to be able to get a loan. They couldn't get a housing loan. They couldn't get a business loan. They couldn't get an equity loan in case they already had a house or a business that they wanted to expand. You weren't getting a loan. And as a result, that meant that certain neighborhoods, particularly in the cities, were starved of capital, right? Because they couldn't get loans. So they had to rent, they had to double up in public housing, they had, you know, essentially they just weren't able to build wealth. So that's how the neighborhood became poor. The reason it became black was because, keep in mind, and I explained this to my daughter in this moment, I said, you know, public housing, these places you see right here, these were created for white people. We think public housing was, like, created for black people, but completely wrong. Black folks weren't even allowed to live in it in the first several years of its existence in most places. It was set up for working class white folks. Right? But then at the very same time that it was created, the government also created some other programs for white folks. The FHA loan program, the VA loan program later, and then the GI Bill benefit program, which theoretically were open to everybody, but in practice were not. For the first 30 years, virtually all the benefits of the FHA program, which allows, you know, first-time home buyers to get a really low interest rate loan, essentially guaranteed by the government. Right, so if you default on it, it's guaranteed by the full faith and credit of the federal government. In effect, that means a government underwritten guaranteed loan. 97% of those benefits went to white families. If you were black or brown, you weren't getting one. That allowed those white folks who had lived in the cities to hustle it out to the suburbs, which were being created at that time, and from which anyone who wasn't white was basically barred from living. Right, so white folks were essentially white flight from the city was government subsidized. Right? It was subsidized by the existence of these low-cost loans. It was subsidized by the interstate highway program that made it easier for people to get out there, but again, only white folks, because black and brown folks couldn't go. Right? And then the people that were left behind were black and brown, who were now increasingly poor because the city had been starved of revenue based on things like redlining. So that's how the neighborhood became black, and that's how the neighborhood became poor. And now we were at the studio, and the lesson was over. Now, I just want you to, and it's, you know, it's more in-depth than that. It's more complicated than that. But that's the basic contours of what happened in community after community after community around the country. That and a few other things. Urban renewal, right, where the government comes in and plowed interstates through black and brown neighborhoods, right, to make way for interstate construction, for office parks, for parking lots, for shopping malls. That was another piece of it. But, you know, I just gave her the thumbnail sketch, yeah? And I want you to think for a minute what happens if I don't have the answer to her question. What if I don't know the answer? Because a lot of people wouldn't know the answer, right? Like, how many of you would have known the answer? And it's not your fault if you don't know the answer, because you weren't taught the answer. I wasn't taught that answer in school. Are you kidding? They didn't teach me that in American history. Hell, I took AP history. That's the history for smart people. And they still didn't teach me that, right? So you can be forgiven for not knowing it, but the problem is if you don't know the answer, what happens when the kid asks the question? Do you think she stops wondering when you don't have the answer? No, she keeps wondering, but now she has to come up with her own answer. What answer do you think she comes up with? If I don't tell her, if I don't give her the historical and sociological background, she's going to default to the only conclusion she can default to in this culture. What is that conclusion? You know what it is, because it's based on the one thing that we were all taught, every one of us in this room, the default position of America. It's the secular gospel of this country. It's our creation myth. Right? What is it? It's the idea that wherever you end up is all about you. If you made it, it's because you worked really hard. And if you didn't make it, it's your own damn fault. You ought to work harder and pull yourself up. That is the guiding principle of Americanism. But I want you to think how dangerous it is, right? Number one, think about it. We all know it's not that simple, right? Like deep down, we all know. Because all of us know somebody, maybe even in our own family, that's worked incredibly hard their whole lives, has nothing to show for it. Hell, we know that the hardest work in this country for generations was done by black and brown folks. They had nothing to show for it. And many of us also know people that were born on third base but still think they hit a triple and haven't actually had to work hard ever. Right? There are people in this country, I'm told, who took advantage of and control of their daddy's $230 million real estate empire in the city of New York in the 1970s when property was cheap, and then turned it into hundreds of millions more and wants you to believe he's a self-made billionaire. Right? So we all know it's not as simple as hard work. We all know deep down, but we have this idea, don't we, about rugged individualism. Rugged individualism is what built America. Not those FHA loans that actually created the white middle class. No, it wasn't that. It wasn't the GI Bill. It wasn't the VA program, right? It wasn't the New Deal programs that put people back to work at a time they couldn't find jobs. No. It was just rugged individualism. Look, there's no such thing as a rugged individual. If you learn nothing else tonight, please learn this. In fact, there's no such thing as an individual abstracted from their social context. Human beings are social creatures. We have never lived in isolation from one another, for God's sake. None of us were raised on an island by a porpoise. I mean, good God, if you actually ever meet a creature that actually qualifies as a rugged individual, please do me a favor, run like hell from that thing. Because whatever that is going to be dangerous. Like, it's going to be feral. It's not going to have language. It's going to try to eat you because it's not going to know that there's a taboo against eating you. Like, do not hang out with a rugged individual, let alone ask them to run your company, for God's sake, right? Or your country, right? There's no such thing as a rugged individual. We exist in social context, but if we believe that that's why we end up where we end up, and I know why we do it, it makes us feel good, right? That we're in charge of our fate. But the problem is, if we are taught that, and then we look around and we see inequality the way we do, right? If my daughter, who's been taught that, not by me, but by the larger culture, right? She picks it up, it's in the air, it's everywhere. Right? If she looks around and sees those folks living over here, not only in an all-black neighborhood or virtually all-black, but in a poor neighborhood, and she's been told that wherever people end up is all about them, what happens? She defaults to a position that's fundamentally racist. Well, there must be something wrong with them, because if there wasn't, they wouldn't be there. So she's able to erase all of history. She's able to erase not just ancient history, but the last 40 years, 50 years, 60 years, she's able to completely ignore sociological context and historical context and political context and just rock her ideology of individualism and meritocracy in a way that forms judgment about the people at the bottom and, by extension, the people who live over here in a more affluent, exclusively white space. Well, they must be superior. So racism becomes rational almost unless you interrogate that dominant ideology of America. Same thing with sexism, because if I look around and I see men disproportionately at the top of various hierarchies and women disproportionately underrepresented in the same, then what do I conclude? I conclude, well, I guess men must want it more. They must work harder. They must be smarter. It rationalizes classism. Well, the rich just must be brilliant and the poor must be lazy. Even though I know there's something wrong with that. Look, there are 37 people in this country right now, 37 people who have the same collective net worth as the bottom half of the American population. 165 million people over here, 37 people over here. If you actually believe that there are 37 people who are as smart as or who have worked as hard as 165 million people, you are on the bad crack. And there is nothing that college can do for you. Drop out and stop wasting my taxpayer money trying to get an education, because you lost if you believe that's even theoretically possible, right? But yet our ideology tells us that. So the reason we need to understand the past and the predicate, as Randall Robinson put it, is so we don't make absurd conclusions about the stuff we're seeing right now. But if my daughter asks that question and I don't give her the answer, she comes to the absurd and fundamentally racist conclusions that we're trying to fight. Now, here's where it gets real dangerous. It's obviously dangerous for the people on the bottom if folks reinforce that mentality, but I want you to think about some other people. What happens if I'm told all of my life that where I end up is all about me? Now, if I'm a person of color, by definition, I may need to come up with, you know, a slightly critical view of that ideology, right? And people of color tend to know that there's way more to it than that, because people of color have to develop a critical sense of that, or else their self-esteem would be completely destroyed, right? If you people of color are three times more likely to be poor, twice as likely to be unemployed, if you're a person of color in that situation and you actually believe the lie of rugged individualism, you're screwed, right? So folks of color, black and brown folks, have always had to have a cynical view of that. I'm not saying everybody has. Some folks fall prey to it, right? There are some folks who do internalize that negativity. But for the most part, to be black and brown is always to be like, yeah, I don't quite buy that. But to be white has been to almost always buy it. Because for the most part, historically, it was true for us. Not always, but mostly. Like if you were white, even if you were white working class, you could at least assume a certain horizontal mobility, couldn't you? You could always assume, well, I work in the coal mine, my daddy worked in the coal mine, his daddy worked in the coal mine, his daddy worked in the coal mine, my son's gonna work in the coal mine, we'll always have coal mining jobs. Or my great-grandfather was a farmer, his son was a farmer, I'm a farmer, my kid's gonna be a farmer, right? There was always an assumption that as long as you had a good work ethic and a good attitude and a strong back and could lift stuff, that you would always have jobs. Now, what happens if I'm told that, and I believe it, because I can, because history says that's how it works for people like me, and then all of a sudden the economy shifts under my feet. And now I'm looking at a global economy that really doesn't give a damn about what my great-granddaddy did, right? What if I'm looking at a global economy that says, yeah, you know what? Manufacturing jobs are not profitable for us who run these companies in Western industrialized model economies anymore. And those manufacturing jobs begin to flee. By the way, they didn't just begin during the presidency of Barack Obama. That's what apparently some folks would like you to believe, the idea that manufacturing factory jobs were plentiful, and then the black guy became president and screwed it all up. Actually, manufacturing jobs have been leaving this country in droves since 1973, at which point I was 5 years old. The manufacturing decline of America has been extended through Republican and Democratic administrations alike. Its biggest collapse actually was during the presidency of Ronald Reagan, just to be clear, right? And yet, we have people who want to act like it's something new. But here's the thing. If the economy is shifting and those jobs begin to flee, and if the coal jobs are declining, and by the way, they're not declining because of environmentalists and because of hippies and regulations, right? It's not because of that. It's not because of the EPA. It's because the guys who own the coal mines have discovered that it is cheaper to get coal by blowing the tops off of mountains than sending a bunch of miners down into the mine to get the coal. Right? Sending miners down is more labor intensive. Blowing the tops off mountains is cheaper for the rich folks that own the mines and don't care if their workers get black lung and die by the age they're 53. So the reason the coal jobs are leaving is not about people trying to overregulate the industry. It's about the people who run the industry trying to make money on the backs of their dead workers. That's the truth. But if the economy shifts and now I can't take those jobs for granted, but remember what I was told, wherever I end up is all about me. Oh, now what do I do? Because now I'm out of work. And now I don't know where my next paycheck is coming from. And now I don't know what my kids are going to do. Are they going to have a life that's as good as mine? Because I could always take that for granted. Black and brown folks couldn't. Black and brown folks couldn't. These white working class folks could. Now they're nervous. Now they're worried. Because if I'm told that wherever I end up is all about me, and now I'm struggling to pay my bills, and now I'm struggling to afford college, and now I'm struggling to afford health care, I have two choices, don't I? Number one is I can default to the ideology I was taught, which says, I'm to blame. I should be working harder. There must be something wrong with me. Because that, after all, is the voice in the back of my head, isn't it? The one that says, come on, double down. Work 50 hours. Work 60 hours. Stop slacking off. Get a second job. Get a third job. Right? So I can blame myself, but then there's a lot of shame associated with that, right? So that's hard to do, because now I start to really hate myself and wonder what's wrong with me. So I have one other option. I can deflect and project that shame and blame onto somebody else. And then a politician comes along, and this politician tells me, I got your pain. I can take away all of your pain, because I can tell you who to blame it on. See? You can blame it on those folks, those brown folks coming across that border. Just this border, though. Just this one. Never this one. Just this one. We're not worried about crafty Canadians, I take it, trying to sneak in, take advantage of our superior health care. Just want to see what expensive health care looks like. I just want to try unaffordability for a minute. You know, we're not worried about that. The Minutemen, they don't camp out on the waters of Nova Scotia looking to shoot people coming across, right? It's only down here we're worried about. But he says, oh, these people are the problem. This is why you're hurting. You can blame them. It's not your own lack of effort. We know you're salt of the earth. We know you work hard, right? It's funny, isn't it, that when working class white folks in like coal country and the so-called Rust Belt are out of work, how all of a sudden we're really sympathetic and we feel like we got to bring jobs to them? That's interesting. Did we do that with black folks in the cities? When black folks in the cities and brown folks in the cities are out of work, is that what politicians say? We got to bring those jobs back to you. My God. No, that's not what we say. What we tell black and brown poor folks in the cities when they're out of work is, y'all need to move. Why don't you get up and go where the jobs are? And if you don't, it's because you're lazy. But if I live in West Virginia and I just want my kids to do the same work that eight generations of men in my family's been doing, that's not seen as a lack of ambition, right? That's seen as, well, that's salt of the earth. That's culturally fantastic, right? People of color, a little bit different judgment. I happen to think that we do need to bring jobs to people, but I also think we need to stop lying to them about why they don't have one now, right? This kid emailed me 2 years ago and said, I can't find a job because all the jobs are going to black people and Mexicans. Really? All the jobs? That's fascinating. How can all the jobs be going to black people and Mexicans when black folks are almost twice as likely as white folks to be out of work, even when they have a college degree, by the way, regardless of their major? Black folks with a college degree, 80% more likely, almost twice as likely as whites with a degree to be unemployed. Latinos with a degree, 50% more likely than whites with a degree to be unemployed. Asian Americans with a degree, 25% more likely than whites with a degree to be unemployed. Our Native brothers and sisters, 2/3 more likely with a degree to be out of work relative to white folks with a degree. So when he tells me that he can't find a job, he may not have a job, but it's not because they took it, right? Where the hell, where are these jobs that black and brown folks are they in Second Life? Is this shit on Minecraft or something? Where the hell are these jobs at? Right? In some video game? They don't exist in the real world. But he was convinced. It's also funny, right? Because the same people who say black and brown folks take all the jobs are the same people that say black and brown folks are lazy. All right, which is it, y'all? Which is it? Because it can't be both. If you took all the jobs, I'm fairly confident the one thing you are not is lazy. And if you are lazy, I'm thinking you didn't even take one job, let alone all the damn jobs. So even though I don't ask much of racists because I expect so incredibly little, the one thing that I do ask for is consistency. Just pick one dumbass stereotype and stick with it so that I don't have to aim at a moving target. There's nothing that I hate more than the moving target idiocy. Just consistent idiocy is all I ask, right? So that's the problem, though. If a politician comes along and says, I got your pain, I can take it, right? I can project, I can allow you to project your own sense of inadequacy, which the culture is telling you to feel, onto somebody else. Psych 101 says, I'm gonna do that, right? Psych 101 says, I'm gonna deflect that and project that onto you. Doesn't necessarily solve my problem, though, huh? Right? Because after all, this idea, oh, you just build a wall, the jobs will come back. Oh, for real? Is that how you think capitalism works? Econ 101, try that one. You think building a wall, what do you think, like, the capitalist of America have been sitting around being like, damn, I just hope they don't figure out to build that wall. Because if they build that wall, we will have no choice but to give them all raises. Really? You think that's what's going to happen? No. Capitalists will always be able to move their money around. Right? The president can say, oh, we're going to stop companies from leaving America. He doesn't have the authority to do that. Twitter doesn't intimidate CEOs. Right? And Congress isn't going to let him actually stop capital mobility, even if he wanted to, and even if he had the power to do so. They have the power to stop that, and they have no intention of allowing capital to be stifled. Capital will always be able to cross borders in search of the highest rate of return. Right? Whether that's a Cayman Island bank account or building the plant in Sri Lanka, they will always be able to do it. And goods will always be crossing borders in a global economy in search of the highest price. So if goods can cross and capital can cross, but you chain labor to its nation of origin and so that they can't seek out the highest wage, all you have managed to do is to rig the game against workers and in favor of capital. Period. And not just for labor down here, but labor north of that border as well. It's not good for working people generally, by definition, to shut down labor mobility but allow capital and goods to be mobile. So it's not going to bring back any jobs, but it allows people to believe that somehow somebody's on their side, right? And it's interesting. There's a story y'all probably heard about, or you've been hearing about for the last year, right? The opioid crisis in white rural America, right? This, it used to be that for a while it was the meth crisis, and now we sort of stepped up the game, you know, from meth to opioids, heroin, oxy, over-the-counter, and street opioids as well. And it's interesting, right? First of all, it's interesting how this is covered in the media. Yes, like all this sympathy that attaches to white drug addicts. It's fascinating, right? Right? All of a sudden, oh, we call it the opioid crisis. And we have people who need treatment and rehabilitation and drug education. And we need sympathy, not prison. These people, they don't need prison. They'll never get help in prison. True. Oddly enough, it's not what we said in the first opioid crisis in this country, which was in the 70s, largely in urban areas of color dealing with street heroin. It was black folks and brown folks, and we called them junkies, and we sought to lock them up. And then in the 80s, it was the crack epidemic again, disproportionately black, brown, and poor, and we sought to lock them up. But now that it's white folks who got hooked on their parents' pain pills and then turned to stuff they can get on the street, oh my goodness, we've got a dilemma. Well, that isn't the biggest problem, actually. That's just sort of an interesting side note. What's really interesting is that the number one or one of the top two or three, depending on which source you look at, one of the top two or three highest correlations with support for Donald Trump in the election, in terms of communities like at the precinct level or at the larger county level, I guess it was the degree of opioid addiction. Now, please don't misunderstand what I'm trying to say here. I'm not saying that you have to be high to have voted for Donald Trump. That's not what I'm saying. It's an interesting argument, but I haven't studied it enough to say. I'm not saying that. What I am saying is I don't think it's a coincidence that the communities where these white folks are in the grips of this opioid addiction are also communities with the highest level of support for a guy who says, I can take away your pain, right? Because what's an opioid? I mean, if you know the pharmacology of this, an opioid is something that blocks pain receptors, right? It doesn't actually solve the underlying cause of the pain, but it blocks pain receptors. It allows an escape from the pain. So in a sense, the president of the United States is a walking, talking, breathing human version of an opioid who comes along and says, I can block your pain. I can take away your problem. Heroin says that, and yet heroin doesn't take away your problem. Whatever it is that's causing you to use or to abuse that illegal opiate is not solved by the taking of that opiate. It simply numbs you, and it dulls you to what's really going on. And that's what we're dealing with now, right? Folks who are so desperate that they'll vote for somebody who says up front, I'm going to take away your health care. I'm going to do it. I'm going to take away, we're going to get rid of the Affordable Care Act. And then you got people in these communities in places like Kentucky, 85% support for Donald Trump, and 60% of them are on the ACA. 60% of them didn't have any health care until the Affordable Care Act was passed, right? But they're all, but they're going to vote for him anyway because, and here's why, right? Because a third of Americans apparently, including a lot of these folks, don't realize that the Affordable Care Act and Obamacare are the same damn thing, right? Well, I didn't think you were going to get rid of the ACA, just that Obamacare. Shit. I mean, I know you're high on heroin, but Google that shit. Like, you don't have to be sober to Google. Or tweet, obviously, you can just use the internet, right? But they go out and vote for it, because why? Because, right, they want a solution for their pain, they want to be able to put it on somebody else. Maybe they think that their health care will be safe, it's just those brown people and those black folks whose health care will be taken. I don't know what it is, but what it is an act of desperation, and I don't want to sound unsympathetic, I'm actually very sympathetic, I'm incredibly sympathetic, because I think folks are being conned. I think they're being lied to by a very good salesperson who convinces them, like pharmaceutical companies convince you with Oxy or heroin dealers convince you with Smack, that they can solve your problem. But this is a long-standing con. This isn't new. So that's the thing, too. Again, understanding the past so you can understand the present. If you learn nothing else, right, learn this, that this con is not something that the president of the United States for the last several weeks thought up. There's no original thought here, right? This is a long-standing tradition that he's just part of. And what is that tradition? Well, it's this. If I had to sum up the history of America in one sentence with regard to race and class, the sentence would be as follows. The history of America is the history of rich white men telling not rich white people that their problems are black and brown people. The history of America is the history of rich white men telling not rich white people that their problems are black and brown people. Here's how we know that to be true. We'll do a real quick 400-year history and make the point. 1600s, the colonies of what would become the United States. At that particular moment, you got a couple of different groups of people in this country. You got rich landowners, very small elite that own everything. And then you have two large groups of essentially peasant class persons. One are African enslaved persons, the other are Europeans, some of whom are indentured servants, one level above enslavement themselves, others of whom are not technically indentured, but they might as well be. They are desperately poor, they have nothing. When you put the peasant class of black folks together and Europeans together, and as well indigenous people whose land is in the process, of course, of being taken from them, they clearly outnumber the elite, right? And it's got to be scary. You're free one of these rich dudes. You're like, you can count, you know, you can do the math on this. You're like, damn, we got to come up with something, because eventually these folks are going to put it together and figure out that we are screwing all of them, and they're going to come and take our stuff, right? Because they're not going to put up with this the way we're treating them. So what do they come up with? Well, in fact, there were some rebellions that took place throughout this period of time in the 1600s, Bacon's Rebellion in Virginia being one of the biggest, but not the only one, where you had African enslaved folks and European indentured servants coming together to overthrow the aristocracy, right? So the aristocracy gets nervous. They create something. What do they create? They create a thing called, maybe you've heard of it, the white race. And you may be thinking to yourself, wait, what? Here's the thing. There's no white race, functionally speaking, historically speaking, culturally speaking, until the colonies of what would become the United States of America. It did not exist. That's not what we called ourselves in Europe. We didn't think of ourselves as one big happy family. Are you kidding? Right? The English hated the Irish hated them back. Northern Italians didn't even think Southern Italians were Italians. Right? The Germans hated everybody. And everybody else felt the same towards them, right? We weren't one big happy family. Europe had spent most of its history killing each other. But in this particular moment, it became necessary for the elite descended from Europe to figure out a way to divide and conquer the peasant class groups. So you create this notion of whiteness and you say, oh, you're all part of it now. Even you peasants with nothing, right? And we're gonna get rid of indentured servitude so you'll never be at the same level as a slave again. And we're gonna give you the right to enter into contracts. And if you're male, at least, we're gonna give you the right to own land. Not much, but a little bit. And we're gonna put you on the slave patrol to keep those people in line. Give you a gun and a badge and a horse and make you feel special. Give you what W.E.B. Du Bois, the great sociologist many years later, would call the psychological wage of whiteness. Well, I might not have much, but at least I'm not black. In other words, it's a way to split you from people that you actually have more in common with. And it worked, and those rebellions stopped because now these poor Europeans were told, oh, you're on our team now. Oh, yeah, you're at the end of the bench, but you got the uniform on. One of these days, you might get in the game. Oh, well, okay then. So all of a sudden, those cross-racial rebellions end. Fast forward to the Civil War era, and you got rich white elites in the South where I'm from. Right, standing up and openly acknowledging why they want to break away from the government. They didn't lie about it back then. We lie now. But they didn't lie about it back then because they weren't ashamed. They were open. They admitted it was about slavery. They admitted it was about white supremacy. Alexander Stevens, the vice president of the Confederacy, said the cornerstone of the new government, the Confederate government, the cornerstone of that government was the great truth that the Negro is not the equal of the white man. He wasn't talking about states' rights and tariffs and economics in the abstract. He was talking about the right of white people to own non-white people. The elite were open about it. Every state that left the Union that issued a declaration of causes said that was the reason, and the only one they listed, by the way. But here's the trick. If I'm rich and I own a bunch of people and I want to break away and form a new government and maybe go to war to protect my right to own those people, but I don't want to fight, what do I do? Because rich people don't go to war. They didn't go to war in the 1800s and they don't go to war now. They get poor people to do that. They get doctors to write notes saying that they have heel spurs so they don't have to go fight in Vietnam. If you're not clear about whom I'm speaking to, whom I am regarding there, you might want to Google that as well later on, right? Rich people have ways of getting out of service. And in this particular case in the 1800s, the rich tell the poor white Southerner, now called white, that you got to go fight for us. Now, why would you do that though? Why would the poor white man go and fight to protect the rich white man's stuff? That's sort of bizarre, isn't it? Like I'm not rich, right? But I got a nice house, and to the extent y'all are students, I probably got more than y'all. So if next week there were an invasion on my block and an army was like traipsing down my street, ready to take my stuff, I don't think I could call y'all on the phone and be like, hey, there's been an invasion, but I don't feel like fighting for my own stuff. But y'all liked my speech last week, so I would really appreciate it if y'all would come to Nashville and defend my shit while I sit out here on the back porch and have a drink. Like, y'all would be like, no, yeah, I like the talk, but no. And you would hang up. Fight for your own stuff, right? But the poor got suckered by the rich. The rich said, you got to do it. How did they do it? They came to them and said, if you don't fight for us, if we lose our way of life, interesting use of the word our, right? The collective we in that regard. If these folks get free, they're going to take your job. Oh my God. No fool, they already have your job. That's the point. If you got to charge $1 a day to work on the farm and you can get that person over there to do it for free because you own them, guess who got the gig? Free got the gig. Free is always, people like free, right? They'll hire free rather than hire your ass that costs $1 a day. So really and truly, working class white folks in the long run probably would have been better off, at least most of them, to overthrow that system because it was actually undercutting the wage base even of most white workers. But again, the psychological wage of whiteness said, I gotta be above somebody. Right? So divide and conquer kept working. It worked so well that by the 1930s, in the midst of the labor union struggle in this country, the height of the union struggle, you had labor leaders, and they're not even the elite. right? I mean, they may be the elite within the working class, but they're not the elite, and yet they had bought into it. So that you had white labor leaders who refused to integrate their unions. And why? Because they would say, well, if we integrate the union, we're just going to reduce the professionalism of our craft. No, fool, it's going to double your union. And then when you go out on strike to get better wages or better working conditions, that will be helpful to have more people on the line with you rather than fewer. And if you don't bring those black folks in, and you don't bring the Chinese labor in, and you don't bring the Mexican-American labor in, guess who the boss is going to hire to replace you when you do go out on strike? Those very same people. And then you'll blame them and not the white boss. And that's exactly what happened. Divide and conquer. Fast forward, we're still dealing with it with regard to immigration. Rather than talking about how to build solidarity among working people, both north and south of that border, we're talking about how we're going to divide certain folks, play them off against one another, blame brown folks for the loss of jobs, rather than actually deal with the truth. You know what the truth is? The truth is that the wealthiest 0.1% of Americans has the same net worth as the bottom 90%. The truth is, right, that six people whose last names happen to be Walton, heirs to the Walmart fortune, five of whom were born in, one of whom married in, have the same net worth as the bottom 40%, 130 million people in this country combined. Do we actually believe that the six people with the last name Walton are that much smarter, work that much harder, that much bigger brains than the rest of us? I would say the odds of that are incredibly small, but that's why we have an economy that doesn't work for everybody, because it's clearly not structured to do so. Corporate America right now is sitting on trillions of dollars, $3 trillion last time I checked. It could be a little more, a little less by now. Roughly $3 trillion worth of money that is parked offshore, right? That they're just sitting on, most of it offshore, not investing it, right? So the odds that a big tax break for corporations is going to suddenly spur job creation, yeah, that worked very well in Kansas. I'm sure you're all in agreement with how well that worked. I mean, you're a lab experiment for everything that's wrong with that economic philosophy, right? Meanwhile, California, which raised taxes and increased regulations, is sort of kicking yours and every other state's ass when it comes to job creation, right? So one model has been proved right, one model has been proved wrong. People keep falling for it. Why are they falling for it in Kansas? Because at least the governor loves the Lord. Long as you loves you some baby Jesus, you can do anything you want. Of course, if baby Jesus were actually a student in the public schools in the state of Kansas, he'd be screwed right about now. But see, that's more of that divide and conquer stuff. Oh, we can just stand strong against the Muslims. If we can just stand strong against black folks in the cities. If we can just stand strong against these refugees from countries that have never done anything to us, then everything will be fine because I can take away your pain and I can take away your fear and I can solve your problem, yet the problem doesn't get solved. Divide and conquer is not about solving problems. It's about keeping certain people running stuff that have always been running stuff. And if you're happy with how it's being run, keep voting for it. If you have a problem with it, you might want to actually explore the history of how this game began and how this con has been run on people from day one. And there's no shame in having fallen for it, because you know what? Every generation of folks have been falling for it for a really long time, but it's time for it to stop. And it's time for us to explore this history and to demand something better of our leaders and of ourselves. It is time for us to stop lying. Because, see, the reason we get away with this with immigration, right, is because we told ourselves a story. And our story sounds like this. Well, I don't mind if they come. I just want them to come the right way legally, like my ancestors. What the hell is that? Legally, like your ancestors. Look, first off, when our European ancestors came, there was no law in place to stop us. So here's the deal. Like, just from a moral perspective, if your great-great-whatever didn't break a law that didn't even exist, he doesn't get patted on the back for being law-abiding, right? You don't get kudos for being law-abiding when you didn't even have a law you could have theoretically broken. Yes? And let's be honest, like when my grandparents, when my great grandparents came here from Russia in the early 1900s, my other great, great, great going back all the way to the 1600s came from England or Scotland or whatever. If Russia, let's say, the most recent part of my immigrant experience in my family, if Russia had been right next door to the United States, right, where coming here would just be a matter of going over a border, right, as opposed to, you know, having to get on a ship and go across the ocean, do I really think that my great-grandfather would have refused to come just because I wouldn't want to break the law? Right? He was desperate. He was being oppressed in Russia, not able to feed his family, support his family. But he's going to just, you know, because he's a good guy, going to be like, sorry, kids, you starve because I wouldn't want to break the laws of the United States. Are you kidding? Would any of our ancestors have made that decision? You think your great-great-whatever would have decided not to come just because the law said not to? That's absurd. But we've told ourselves a story. And the other story we've told is, well, you know, our people came for freedom, and they're just coming for stuff. What? Right? I mean, that's sort of what Trump said. Trump said, you know, Mexico's not sending their best. The hell, you think England sent their best? Have y'all studied the history of England and who came and who didn't? The best did not get on the boat, y'all. Like, that's the deal. The best never leave where they're at. If they're the best, they're winning, right? The winners don't get on the damn boat. The winners don't leave. The winners stay because the winners are winning where they're at, right? In 1647, there was no conversation like this. Just imagine, if you will, an English countryside, and there is a lord and baron or whatever the hell they're called, really important person close to the king, and he gathers his family around the fireplace and says, all right, children, So here's the thing. I've been giving this a lot of thought, and I know we're doing pretty well, right? We've got this big mansion, and we got all this gold, and it's fantastic. And I know, like, last weekend, we were at the king's palace. You like that, right? You play with his children. I know. It was brilliant, right? It was great. It was great. Well, here's the thing. I know it was fun, and you like it here, especially because we have all of this acreage. But your mom and I have been consulting, not much because, you know, she's your mom, and it's 1647, and I don't really have to take her opinion seriously. But we've been talking about this, and we've sort of come to the conclusion, or who am I kidding? I have come to the conclusion that what we really ought to do, in spite of all this great stuff we've got, is just say, screw it. Gather up a couple of things, get on a boat. A rickety old ship, like, I don't even know if it's seaworthy, like, it might sink, we might get hijacked by pirates, eaten by sharks, die from scurvy, but here's the thing, if we make it, which is a very big if, but if we make it, I think we will all be able to look back at this and say what a wonderful adventure it was. Okay, that never happened. The winners did not get on the boat. The people who came were the losers of their respective societies. And I'm not saying that to be judgmental or pejorative. I don't mean loser in a negative way. I mean what James Baldwin said about them. He said that Europeans came because they were starving and some of them were convicts and they couldn't make it in the old country. And there's no shame in that. The shame comes when you look at newcomers who have the same story. And you don't see yourself in them, and you don't see them in you. And then that's when you start talking about building walls, and that's when you start talking about keeping people out, and that's when you start proclaiming a certain ethnic, cultural, or racial supremacy that ignores the entire history of how you people got here in the first place. See, we deserve better than that. But until we demand an accurate history, until we face the past, until we acknowledge how the past affects the present, we keep making these mistakes. And we don't solve our problem. And we got like 30 years, because in 30 years, half this country is going to be folks of color, half are going to be white. By the way, that's not about immigration. Right? Because some people say, well, that we can stop that if we just stop immigration. No, that's got nothing to do with immigration. The last 8 years, there's been a net outflux of immigrants, by the way. Contrary to popular belief, oh, they're pouring over the borders. They're pouring over the borders. Actually, there has been a net outflow of immigrants over the last 8 years, more leaving than have been arriving. That is a fact. And facts do matter. But even if there's no immigration from this day forward, or even if the outflow continues to be net negative, the demographics will continue to change. Why? Because the white population is older by about 8 or 9 years on average than the Latino or black populations or Asian American populations, and older folks generally die first. Right? And younger folks are more fertile, so they have higher birth rates in their populations. Doesn't have to be a big difference either. It's not huge. It's just enough, however, to change the demographics in about 30 years just based on birth and death rates, fertility, et cetera, right? So within 30 years, half the country is going to be folks of color, half are going to be white. That's a fact. We can either create equity or we continue on this path. And I'm going to tell you right now, if we can't figure out equity, none of us are going to survive this thing. How are we going to have a functional economy if half the population is twice as likely as the other half to be out of work? Three times as likely as the other half to be poor. 1/15 the net worth of the other half. Double the rate of infant mortality. 9 years less life expectancy. Double the rate of low birth weight children. That is not a recipe for a functioning society. It's a recipe for total social collapse, period. So this is not charity work we're talking about. We talk about racial equity and joining the struggle for racial equity. We're talking about radical self-help. The kind of stuff that we all have to get involved in doing if we actually love this country. And that's the great irony, isn't it? Because those of us on the left, we're the ones who get tagged with not loving America. We're the ones who get told that we hate America. We're the ones that told that if we don't like it, we can leave it. But we're the only ones who actually believe that we can do better, see? Because the folks on the right, they're the ones who apparently are content with a 2-to-1 unemployment rate between black and white, a 3-to-1 poverty rate between black and white, who throw up their hands, shrug their shoulders, and say, well, I guess that's the best that we can do. Right? People who are content with racial profiling, people who are content with the fact that black men in this country and black women are 3 times more likely per capita to be shot even when unarmed relative to white folks. They're content with that. I'm not. Or people on the right who are not only content with how it is now but want to go back to the way it was before. See, some folks are looking behind them and the rest of us are looking ahead. And the real question is, who's more cynical? Who's more hateful? Who really loves their country and who doesn't? The one who suggests that our best days are ahead of us if we choose to make it so, or those who insist the best days are behind and we've all gone to hell in a handbasket. I'm here to tell you, not the ones who are looking behind, right? Only those of us who are prepared to actually make this country live up to its promise are actually worthy of being called lovers of country and the people who live in it. We're the ones who actually care enough to get dirty and do the work, get our hands messy and do the work. Those of us who are willing to actually dig down deep into the core of who we are as a people and do the work, not so that we can make America great again, but so we can make it great for the first damn time. Thank you all so much for being here. I appreciate you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. What's that? Yeah.
So on behalf of Emporia State University, we would just like to thank you, Tim Wise, again for such an awesome lecture. So what we're going to do, we're going to get ready for Q&A, and we will have a mic right here as well as a mic over here, and we will be able to take 10, maybe 8 to 10 questions based on time. So if you're interested in asking Tim Wise a question, I ask that you get up now and go to a mic or forever hold your peace. Thank you.
Or if you are, if you're physically unable to get to the mic, you can also let us know and we'll call on you. Or if you're just one of those folks that, you know, some people are just sort of a little more shy about getting up to the mic, and I can appreciate and respect that too. And so we'll figure out a way to get to you if that's the case. But we'll start here and we'll just sort of go back and forth. So we'll start right here at this mic and then we'll go over there. Yeah. I don't know, is it on? Maybe the switch has to be. That didn't do it either.
I'll just project.
There we go, there we go.
Hey, I'm Ravel, I'm with the Bulletin. I'm a reporter from the Bulletin.
Yeah.
My question is, I'm sure that a lot of people are here because they're interested in what you have to say, but there are a lot of people who should be here who aren't. How do we get those people involved in the conversation of social justice?
Well, you know, I'm of mixed mind on this. I mean, obviously, you know, the more that you have the conversation, the more likelihood that people will be caught up in the web of that conversation at some point. So I think that, you know, the short answer is you just keep having the conversation until people get dragged and compelled to come. Maybe it's because the people who came this time go back and tell people who weren't there, hey, you really ought to come. And, you know, then they bring two people and they bring two people. But my mixed mind piece of this is, look, you know, yeah, I want everyone to come and engage in this discussion, but I also realize that sometimes preaching to the choir, quote unquote, isn't always bad. And the reason I say that, and I'm not saying that everyone in here is the choir. I'm sure there's a wide plethora of views in the room, even though there was a lot of support for most of the things that I said. But the choir, you know, I'm from the South, man. I've been around choirs a lot. And one thing I've learned about choirs is they need practice, right? Like, sometimes you'll be in a church and the choir will be singing and you're like, y'all should have worked harder on that. Like, that's not even the same song. Well, I don't know what you're singing, but your harmonies are off, you know? And so I think part of it is practice. And the more we practice and the more we engage, the better we'll get at it, whether or not new people are coming in. And then there's also part of me that's like, I don't necessarily want the adversary in the room all the time. I don't want them to know what I'm planning. I don't want them to necessarily know what we're thinking. So I'd love for more people to be engaged and have these hard conversations, but it can't be forced. And in the meantime, we gotta talk to the ones who come. And we got to build with the ones who come. You know, there's always that conversation. Are we trying to convert people from point A to point Z? Or are we just trying to move people from point F to point T or something, right? I think a lot of people are already maybe at point F, but they need to get down here. And these folks at point A, I don't know, maybe they'll get over here. But I'm not an evangelical leftist. I'm just a leftist, just doing my thing, and people either buy it or they don't, and they come to it in their own time, I think, to some extent. So we just keep trying, you know. Yeah, over here.
Good evening. My name is Shaquille Anderson. I'm here with Westar Energy. We definitely enjoyed your lecture tonight.
Thank you.
My question is pretty simple. What inspired you to become an expert in this area?
Well, first, I don't want to claim to be an expert. I know a little something, but you know, what inspired me to take on the issue, you know, I think it always comes down to upbringing and background and who you know and who you met and who came into your life. I could have easily gone a different direction. I mean, if you had told me that when I was 16 that this is what I'd be doing, I wouldn't have been surprised from a dispositional point of view, but I would have been shocked that would have been the direction, because I didn't really see it that way. But I had parents who brought me up with a certain sensitivity and a sensibility. I went to preschool at a historically black college at the age of 3 and 4, so that most of my peer group were black kids. The authority figures were black women. I learned to respect black authority in that setting. And that meant that 23, 24 years later, when I was organizing in public housing in the city of New Orleans, listening to black women tell me about their lives, I wasn't going to be the white guy that said, "Are you sure you're not crazy? Like, I think you might be hallucinating." All right? I was going to be the white guy that, because I could go back to that early imprinting in preschool where black women were running the show, and I could be like, "Oh, okay, I hear you, I see you, I'm listening to you, I can take your authority seriously." So I think that was an important cornerstone. But then I went to school in New Orleans, and I had amazing mentors that really helped to form me and mold me into a better activist and a better educator. Right, and gave me a depth of knowledge that I didn't have. And I'll tell you, you know, as much as anything, it was the people I met in public housing. It was the women mostly who I worked with in public housing communities that were more knowledgeable in so many ways about race and class and the interaction of those things than anybody I'd ever met in a classroom. Like, they knew more about it than the folks with the PhDs, and they lived it. And so I was just very lucky, very fortunate to be immersed in a community that embraced me and that taught me and then encouraged me to get out and to do this work. So that's the short version of the answer to that. Yeah. Over here, please. Yes.
Hello. My name is Murad Jalilov, and I come from a family of political asylees here in the U.S. and basically, my question is that when we immigrated here, our government put us as white Caucasian, and that's what we are. We're Eastern European. Mm-hmm. But the problem I've been like facing here is that if we talk in terms of identity politics, some minorities would see me as white and privileged, but some white people would see me as a minority and mm-hmm. underprivileged. So mm-hmm. how do I deal with the situation? It's kind of, I'm stuck in a limbo.
Right.
If we look in those terms.
Yeah. No, it's a very good, it's an interesting story, and it's one that a lot of people have. And I think it really demonstrates the absurdity of race as a concept, right? The fact that the United States definitions of these things are entirely fluid. The fact that we refer to people who are from the so-called Middle East as white, even though you know full well that post 9/11, most white people certainly don't consider them to be white. The fact that we consider, you know, people from the Caucasus Mountain region, that's like where we get our anthropological name, as Caucasians, and yet, you know, the two guys that were the Boston bombers at the marathon were from the Caucasus region, and I don't think anybody views them as white because Islam has been racialized as non-white. So it's all this messed up jumble of ideas that mean very little. It's why Mississippi defined black as one drop of black blood, South Carolina 1/8, others were 1/16, you know, it's all ridiculous. But now, socially, these things have been given meaning. And so the place that you find yourself is interesting on a couple of levels, right? The thing about privilege is that it's fluid, and sometimes it works for you and sometimes it doesn't. And so there are times when someone can, I hate to use the word pass because it almost sounds like you're trying to do it, but a person can be perceived as white and reap the benefits of that. That might be when you're, you know, going for a job or trying to get a loan or having an interaction with a police officer. There are other times when that very same person, and it could be you, will be perceived by someone else as not white. And you never know when you're in that sort of limbo position. Now, what this does that I think is interesting and you might be able to take advantage of, and I would highly like recommend that you try to do so, as weird as the position must be and as off balance as it must make you feel sometimes, it also allows you to be privy to some conversations that maybe other people aren't, right? So in other words, and it's the same way I feel about people that are like multiracial or biracial or people who are transracially adopted, right? Like you're in these different worlds. And as a result, people don't always know what world you're in, right? So you might be in a certain situation where people are perceiving you as quote unquote white and they're saying stuff about people of color that's really, you know, jacked up and problematic that you find horribly offensive, but that they share with you because they think you're one of them in the way that they think of themselves. And then there are other times that you might be perceived as a person of color and you're experiencing some things like that, that the quote-unquote whiter part of you and the way you're perceived doesn't always notice, and you can talk about that. You're sort of in a world where you're going to experience both sides of the color line at various times, right? And I think that's an interesting place. It's also, I'm sure, a very off-balancing place to be, but you'll be able to gain some experiences and some insights from it that you can share with other people, which actually will point out the ridiculousness of the whole concept of race. And so I think that's actually a position that you can use, some leverage that you can use to demonstrate how absurd this whole concept is. Not how absurd it is to talk about identity, because identity has real social meaning, but how absurd it is to fixate on it to the point of saying that there's such a thing as white people. And there's such a thing as non-white people, when really it's this continuum, and it's whatever we decide to make it. You know, it's whatever, it's whoever we decide to make white this month. And it's sort of like South Africa, you know, under apartheid, referred to Japanese business people as honorary whites. That was literally what they were called. Like Asian business people and Middle Eastern oil kingdom business people were referred to as honorary whites. Well, how are you an honor? What does that even mean? An honorary white? Well, that's just the word we use so we can keep getting your money, right? Because clearly we don't consider you white, but we're going to help. We're going to put you above all these other, you know. So, I mean, it's an interesting sort of proof that this whole thing is ridiculous and needs to be taken apart, you know. Thank you for your question. Yes, over here.
Good evening, Tim. My name is Michelle de la Isla. My job is diversity and inclusion. And on top of that, I'm also on City Council in Topeka. So hearing you talk about this is rather interesting. When I look at the room, I see, like you said, students that have to be here, and a lot of us that believe in what you're saying. So I drank the Kool-Aid, of course. How do we take this message for individuals that are not accepting the message and help them understand so that we could really make transformation? Because we're pretty much up front, and I think that we turn people off.
Yeah.
So how do we do this so that we could change minds and hearts?
Well, I do think that the key, and I think there are two main keys, one of which I tried to focus on a little bit this evening, which is the, you know, acknowledging the real pain and insecurity of people, but trying to redirect their diagnosis of it, right? So I think it is important to acknowledge that, you know, God, when you've had all the privilege and the advantage historically, it must really be scary to have to share. I get it. Like, man, if you've had 100% of the stuff, to only have 90 must be scary, and now to only, oh my God, I'm only going to have 70, maybe that feels like oppression. Now, that seems absurd on the one hand, but wow, that's sort of, you've been set up. And my thing to white people is, I think white folks have been set up, white men in particular, have been set up to always expect this. And if you have that level of expectationalism, anything short of that, it's like the world is coming to an end. It's incredibly fragile. You know, white masculinity is incredibly fragile, which is why that guy can go off in that Starbucks video when he gets slow service from a black barista, right? You've seen this thing on YouTube, right? Where this guy just like loses his mind and starts going off calling racial slurs to a black barista. Listen, if you think oppression is getting your latte with the wrong kind of milk, right, then you've just proven to me how privileged you are, right, and how incredibly fragile you are. But that's where white dudes who have just like, I've always been, I'm an American, I'm the prototype, I'm the, you know, I'm the center of the universe, and now we're starting to realize, no, sweetheart, we're not. No, precious, it isn't all about us, you know, and it never really was, but if you've been led to believe that, you know, then everything else seems like it's the end of the world. And so, now, here's the thing. I don't think people of color ought to spend 1 second indulging that bullshit, right? But that's my job as a white person. I got to deal with my people. We got to come for our people. That's not black and brown folks' job. Black and brown folks have just got to survive and figure out how to move forward. I'm not saying that people of color need to indulge that nonsense for 1 second, but sadly, that's my burden, right? That's white folks. That's our cross to bear, so to speak, which is a weird metaphor for a Jewish kid to use. But anyway, we have to do that, right? And so that, to me, that's our job. But I think that, at least in part, the other piece, which I didn't really do here because it doesn't translate as well in a larger lecture, but I try to do this in a one-on-one type of situation. And that's where we find ourselves more often, not these big sort of public lectures, is I think it's really important to share narrative, right? I mean, I shared some stories tonight that I thought, you know, maybe helped try to make a point, but I think that's really how we get to people, right? It's rarely with the data, it's rarely with the facts, it's rarely with the studies and the theory and the statistics. That works for certain types of people. But what we know from the brain science research is it doesn't work with most. What does work seems to be personal narrative, relationship building, hearing the stories of people. So like, for instance, you know, if we're talking about the refugee ban and the Muslim travel ban on these handful of nations, there, I guess, are two main strategies for pushing back. Well, you know, one is you just get the courts to say no, which is what they did tonight, in case you hadn't checked your Twitter feeds. So it's going to be an interesting evening around 3 a.m. on Twitter. but the other strategy, right, you have two choices politically, I guess. One is the strategy a lot of people have been using, which is pointing out, and it's true and it's worth pointing out, that none of the nations on this travel ban, none of their nationals have done anything terroristic in this country against American citizens, whereas several of the countries not included in the travel ban have had nationals who have done things, including 9/11, but they're not on the travel ban. Not that they should be, by the way, because still, we're talking 19 hijackers out of a lot of people. It's not a representative sample. But it's interesting which ones were left out and where certain people have business interest. But here's the thing. Here's the thing. Is that that idea, that argument that these are not people who actually pose any significant risk can be statistically pretty well proven, but people who don't care about facts and statistics won't care. The other approach, and I think this is a much better one, right, is to tell the story of some of these refugees and some of these folks who were unable to get, and we're talking children that were coming here for medical care. We're talking doctors. There's a young woman from Iran who was just kept out of the country the other day who is apparently trying to come back. She had a fellowship or something, or no, maybe it was residency or something at a hospital. She's one of the foremost young experts on Alzheimer's in the world, and she's now unable to come back in. I mean, these stories, right, about who's really being affected. Same thing with the repeal of the Affordable Care Act. I mean, the Affordable Care Act is all kinds of flawed in a million different ways, but there are people, real people, who are alive today who very simply would not be alive but for that act, and there are people who will absolutely, positively die if it is repealed without a substitute that provides exactly the same or better care, none of which substitute has been proposed. And so, at this point, those stories are going to be more effective, right? The stories of you know, I told a group earlier today that I was meeting with some students this. I'll tell you again real quick the short version. Back in the mid-90s when I was doing organizing in public housing, and we were trying to figure out how to reach people, sort of like the ones you're talking about, because it was in the middle of the welfare reform debate. And for those who recall those days, you know, the Clinton administration ended up supporting and signing a welfare reform bill passed by the Republican Congress that many of us progressive folks certainly felt was way too punitive, was based on a lot of lies about welfare recipients, a lot of dishonesty and distortion about single moms receiving public assistance. And so we fought like hell to stop it. We lost. But during that time, I remember going on the radio to try to make the case that this bill was bad. And so I go on the radio, and I sort of came with this mentality because I was a competitive debater by nature, and that's what I did in high school and partly in college. And so I used to think, like, winning arguments was the most important thing. And I got really good at winning arguments, right? So I came into the studio with, like, all the facts at my disposal. I had all these little note cards and pieces of paper, and I spread them out all over the board where the calls come in, and I was ready. No matter what you called with, I was ready. You wanted to call and tell me how single moms were having all these quote-unquote illegitimate babies, I had the data to show that you were wrong. You want to tell me how they're living high on the hog, getting all this money from the government, and, you know, living tax-free, blah, 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 and making thousands, I had the evidence to prove that you were wrong. You want to tell me they're on welfare for five generations in a row? I had the data to tell you that you were wrong. All these calls come in. Somebody says one stupid thing, I got you. Bam. Then somebody else calls in, says another stupid thing. Got you. Bam. Third person calls in, says something. I'm like, wait, hold up. Oh, there it is. Bam. Right? And at the end of the show, I'm convinced I got it. Like, I've proven to the satisfaction of every thinking person, right, that our position is correct. And that theirs is wrong. Last guy calls in. And I'm feeling real good right about now until he says what he says. He says, well, you know what they say. Liars always figure, and figures always lie. Click. And I was just like, what the hell was that? Right? Well, what does he mean? That's an old saying. It basically says, you know, people who lie will always find numbers to help them lie, and numbers always distort. And I was like, holy hell, facts don't matter, right? Doesn't matter. So then I realized all that hard work I had just done had been for nothing. And, you know, and I'm like, God, it made me horribly depressed. And this is like, I had a sense of what alternative facts meant many years before that term was being used. It's like, holy shit, it just doesn't matter. And then I went back and I'm like, but it does matter. And how am I going to do better? And the next time I went on that show, rather than trying to just overwhelm with evidence, I decided to start telling stories about the women and the families that I was meeting, the people that I was getting to know, right? To talk about their actual struggles, to talk about how hard they did work, in fact, to talk about how they tried to keep it together for the sake of their kids and their community. And I would be lying if I told you that all the people that were hostile called up and were like, oh my God, you totally converted me, thank you for that. But I will say the calls became less hostile, and I did feel that there was some progress made. So I think the way we reach people, other than repetition, obviously, other than trying to appeal to their interest, which is what I tried to do tonight, which is to say your interests are served better if you don't misdiagnose your pain. That's another part of it. But the other piece is the narrative form and really the storytelling form, which I think the right does a better job of. You know, Ronald Reagan told a story. It was really a lie, but he told it beginning in 1976 about a welfare queen driving Cadillacs to the welfare office who had 135 different names, 85 social security numbers, and was collecting $1 million tax-free from the government. This was absolutely a lie, absolutely 100% false. And yet he told the story and it convinced a lot of people, and that's where the whole notion of the undeserving welfare queen came from. So I think the right has understood marketing for a very long time. Those of us on the left understand sociology. Sociology is very important. Marketing is what wins a country. And so we're going to have to learn how to tell stories as well as the other side. Yes, over here, please.
Thank you, Tim. James Bordenero, I'm an attorney here in town.
Yeah.
I think you actually just hit on what I was going to talk about, because you paint a dire picture of how the left is losing it and all these things. And yet we had a black president for 8 years. And we had a situation, I agree 100% with you, that the Electoral College and the entire system of having a bicameral legislature is a product of racism.
Yeah.
But despite that, we elected a black president.
Yeah.
And I think that the election doesn't necessarily come down to, this current election didn't come down to the fact that you had an electoral college.
Right.
Because that's been known a long time. You had, a flawed candidate.
Yeah. Oh, of course.
And I would suggest to you that people are maybe a little bit out in the heartland, a little smarter about all this, because maybe we looked at two candidates and didn't see a whole lot of difference. Maybe we did go for the shiny object. Mm. But you talked about the welfare bill. Well, let me add the 1994 crime bill.
Right.
Okay? Right. That's an example where people just didn't see one candidate, a whole lot of difference between the two. And so you also point to a lot of sociological phenomena.
Uh-huh.
And I know we've got Joe Manchin voting with the Republicans
pretty
much all the time, and he's still peddling that line that the jobs are coming back to West Virginia or not. But maybe we are not as screwed as you point out. Maybe we can get better. And if nothing else, look at that the Women's March. I mean, the largest march ever. So I think we're in a good place.
No doubt. In fact, I would say it is a dire picture only in the sense that it reminds us of how incredibly broken we have always been and remain when it comes to race and economics and a lot of other things. But you're absolutely right. If nothing else, I think it has, by virtue of reminding us of that, and by virtue of reminding us of how easy it is to be distracted potentially by the shiny object, or how broken our system is, it has resurrected a certain degree of civic-mindedness and motivation for action that I think we absolutely can build upon. There has to be some positive that we tease out of every negative, or else we become cynical and defeatist. And I'm certainly not that. Couple of things in regard to your comments. Let's remember a couple things, because people are quick to say we elected a black president. But let's be very clear about who we is in this country, because we, broadly speaking, didn't. In 2008, every demographic of white people, except for the youngest demographic of white people, voted against Barack Obama. In 2012, every demographic, including younger white people, voted against Barack Obama. So if it is not for people of color, he doesn't win, probably the first time for sure, and he certainly doesn't win re-election. Now, I am not saying, by the way, that if you voted against Barack Obama, that makes you a racist. That has never been my position. Just like I've been very clear that if you voted for him, that doesn't mean you ain't one. Right? Because you could have voted for the person of color and still hold deeply racist views about the larger black community. In fact, there was a survey taken a month before the election in 08, late September, that found that something like 27%, it's in my book, Between Barack and a Hard Place. I just can't remember the exact stat, but I think it's 20. Yeah, I'm clever like that. Yeah, you should check that out. 27%, I think it was, of white Democrats who said, yes, I'm going to vote for Barack Obama, and I believe that they were probably telling the truth, but they still believed in at least one, if not several, anti-black stereotypes. So in other words, I don't like most of them, but that one's okay. So I want us to always separate the fact that we can carve out exceptions for individuals of color who we find appealing, and we might still hold other people of color in negative regard. Same thing with women as women. We might find certain women appealing, but still look down on women as a group. So that would be the first point. The second point is, look, this outcome, let's be real clear. I don't believe that this presidential election tells us very much of anything about where the American people are, because not only did Donald Trump lose by 3 million votes, but even in the states that he won that allowed him to win the Electoral College, the key states, he won by a combined total of like 72,000 votes, which means if you flip 36,000 the other way, the election's totally different. So clearly, let's not overstate that it somehow says, oh my God, that there's been this massive revival of racism. That's not my argument. In fact, I would say, look, from a party perspective, if your primary issue is how do you win an election in 4 years, that really isn't that hard, right? You run a better candidate, perhaps. You run a candidate that, you know, doesn't have some of the negatives that this one had, although I don't want to overstate them, because most of those negatives were negatives that this guy had at least. I mean, like, she's dishonest. Okay, turn on your phones and count the lies. Just in, I mean, it's you know, one has had a problem with the truth. The other is clinical, 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 clinical. Like, I don't honestly know the last time that the other one told the truth. And at least Hillary Clinton acknowledged she was wrong about that crime bill. She was horribly wrong about it at the time, as was Bill Clinton. But she had since apologized and said she was wrong. And now this guy says he wants to do stop and frisk on a national level and issued an executive order today, in case y'all hadn't heard, that's talking about essentially unleashing the police, which you can't even do by executive order. Like, he just thinks you can write executive orders for anything and then hold up the executive order and show everybody your fancy signature. And they're like, oh, he's mandated joy for everyone. He's, you know, he's mandated no more sadness. You know, he's, I mean, it's like, he's mandated they're gonna say Merry Christmas at the Target. You know, what? Like, you know, this is just, so I don't think, I think most Americans, frankly, I think most Americans are smarter. And I think the mistake, I'll tell you, I think the biggest mistake that that Secretary Clinton made was, there were two, right? One is, if you want to go after a candidate, go after the candidate, not the candidate's supporters. It's usually not a good look, right? Even if you're right about some of them and their views, it doesn't work. Like, when I started doing this work fighting David Duke in Louisiana, yeah, I knew that a lot of Duke supporters were straight up racist, but that wasn't our message. Our message was, this guy's a Nazi and you shouldn't vote for him. And it wasn't like, all y'all are a bunch of Nazis because you want to vote for him. Because the last thing you want to do is tell people that they're horrible people. They generally do not respond well to that, right? The second thing, I think, I mean, and this would have been smarter, in my opinion, would have been to actually look at those voters and say, you know, here's the thing. I don't think you're racist, but that guy does, because he's trying to play to your fears. He thinks you're so racist that if he blames brown people, you'll vote for him. He thinks you're so religiously bigoted that if he talks about Muslims, you'll vote for him. He thinks you're so, in other words, make it about him suggesting that about you rather than me telling you that that's who you are. Like, there are a lot of things, there's a lot of sympathy and empathy we need to have for people who we don't always articulate very clearly. And I think most people are open to that message. And I think we're beginning to see that. So I absolutely don't want us to become cynical or feel defeated. I think in this moment, there's an incredible upsurge of activity that's taking place. Part of it, let's be honest, has been happening for 3 years with the Movement for Black Lives. It's not all new. Some people are new to it. Other people have been at it for a very long time. And I think that we can take advantage of that and that we can build on something. You know, it's not, sometimes people ask, well, is the glass half full or the glass half empty? That's always the wrong question. By definition, it's always both, right? If it is half full, it is also half empty. The only real question is, are refills coming? That's the only question. And if the refills are coming, we're good. And if they're not, we're screwed. That's the issue. We have to do the refilling. Yes, over here, if there's another one over there, yes.
Okay, so I've actually been pondering on this question since the election, and I watched The 13th, which I'm sure you've seen.
The documentary, sure.
Yeah, so he talks about how black people are in a lot of, you know, like big cities, like you talked to yourself. So I'm thinking California, New York, you know, places, Harlem and things like that. And you talked about how the Electoral College is racist. I don't know. That's the way I view it. So I don't know. I wanted to ask you about it because I've talked about it with people, and I feel like I'm being, you know, a crazy liberal millennial, and it was kind of validated to hear you say that, and I was wondering if you could just kind of clarify and maybe tell us how we can change that without a constitutional law degree.
Well, here's the thing. You can't get rid of it without a constitutional amendment, and you ain't gonna get a constitutional amendment to get rid of it, because the folks who benefit from it are not gonna wanna get rid of it. you have to have so many states vote for that, and they're not going to because many of the states that would have to vote for it benefit from it. It increases their power. You have states with very small populations that end up with outsized power relative to, same thing with, you know, the fact that we have states, every state has two senators. That means that small states end up with far more representation per member of the population than states with more people. That's going to be that way. Now, there is, however, a movement afoot short of a constitutional amendment that might help check that a little bit. There's a movement that several states have been looking into, and several states have sort of said they're down to do it, that would essentially say that in their state legislatures, they are talking about passing a law. It's like this interstate compact a bunch of states have agreed to sign on to, whereby they would agree that even though the Electoral College still determines, you know, the vote, that they will cast their Electoral College votes for whoever the winner of the popular vote is, right? In other words, yes, you're still going to use this mechanism, but we are pledging that whatever the popular vote is, we will send our votes in that way. Now, the problem is right now, I think all but maybe one of the states that's agreed to do that, or maybe two states, are sort of blue states who are going to do that because they sort of know how the popular vote's probably going to go. But there are a couple of states, including those that are not blue states, that have shown some interest in it. And so there may be some movement there where it would be, you know, we're not going to necessarily get rid of the Electoral College, certainly not anytime soon, but we might be able to check the power of the Electoral College by requiring voters, or at least not requiring, but saying in these states, we're going to cast our votes however the popular vote goes, even if that's not how it went in our state, which you can do now, by the way, except in certain states where that's prohibited. Certain states say you have to cast your votes the way that your popular vote went, or else you can be fined like $1,500, or you can be removed from your position of authority if you have a position of authority in the party or as an elector, but it's not much of a punishment. I don't think there's any serious penalties. So that may be the only way to check it. But we just need to have a conversation about, while we're moving toward that, just what does it mean that we have a system that is so antiquated, that's rooted in some very anti-democratic tendencies, and that is so clearly, I mean, I don't see how we maintain a functioning democracy in a society where this continues to happen. This has happened now twice out of the last, four elections. And I got to tell you, right now, I mean, if you really want to get serious, let's think about it. The Republican Party has only been able to win the popular vote in one presidential election since 1988, right? That's the truth. And that was in 2004, after 9/11, whoever was president was going to get reelected almost inevitably in wartime. It almost always happens. So you can't even give George W. Bush that much credit for winning reelection that time, right? You really can't, because it was a wartime president, and it was, so one time, if I'm a Republican, and I'm not, but if I were a Republican, I would be seriously worried, not about my ability to sort of jerry-rig the process by state redistricting, oh, I know I can do that, or by the Electoral College, oh, I know I can do that, but I would have a real crisis of legitimacy if year after year after year after year my agenda was rejected by a pretty clear majority of Americans. If I can't convince the majority of Americans to support my candidates, what is wrong with me? And if I'm a Democrat, which I also, by the way, am not, right? But if I were a Democrat affiliated with that party, I'd be asking the same question about, you know, off-term elections and midterm elections and what, you know. But instead, we just have people that are trying to figure out, well, how can I game it to my advantage, whether it's this system over here, whether it's this system over there, rather than actually asking, what does it mean when we are trying to pass an agenda that is not supported? And they don't seem to care. It's just sort of like, well, he has a mandate. A mandate to do what? When you lose by 3 million votes, you don't have a mandate. When you win three states combined by 70,000 votes, that's not a mandate. But that's what they keep tweeting out. It was a landslide victory. What the hell does a landslide victory mean? If you won every state by one vote, right, it would be what? That would be 540 electoral votes to none. But it wouldn't be a landslide because you won every, or be 538 or whatever. It would be 538 electoral votes to zero. But to call it a landslide would be ridiculous because you won by one vote in each state. But that, you know, so we have a bigger crisis even than just the Electoral College. It's this system that is predicated on fundamentally anti-democratic outcomes and shows a level of division that no one seems to want to work with. And we better figure out how to work with it. You know, I don't think Barack Obama had a clear mandate to do stuff either. And that's one of the reasons that he tried to find some kind of balance and some kind of compromise. And it drove me a little nuts, right? Because as someone who's well to Obama's left, I wanted him to go for it and do more stuff. But he sort of had this consummate, you know, sort of compromise mentality based on the idea that surely these people over here will want to work with me. Well, clearly not. And so the real question is, do we continue to try to be ecumenical and work with people? That's what people are counseling. But, you know, I don't know. If you bring a butter knife to a gunfight, you know, you get shot. And you lose every time. So I'm not sure what the approach is, but I know we better start asking these fundamental questions about the legitimacy of our leaders. Because if I'm leading from 3 million votes behind, and I can't convince people, you know, in any way, shape, or form that I'm correct, even in states that I win very, very closely in most instances. I'd be worried about what that says, but that's the difference between me and probably most of you on the one hand and certain other people on the other hand. Over here, yeah. Oh, you're just guarding the mic. Okay, yeah, go ahead, and then we'll come back over here.
This will be my last question.
Okay.
Because I'm back again. Last semester, I wrote a column, and it was titled, Dear White People, Stop Saying Nigga. And
Dear White People what?
Dear White People, Stop Saying Nigga.
Oh, okay.
And it got a lot of backlash. People were like, oh, stop saying, you know, why you gotta point out white people? And I'm like, you're white, you know? I don't understand why I couldn't. It's like it's a problem if I say that they're white for some reason. Mm-hmm. But there seems to be a stigma with the fact that the phrase, Dear White People, is racist. I heard that a lot. So is Dear White People racist? Why or why not?
I mean, here. No. but I mean, here's the thing. Like, how can white folks get bent out of shape when other people use the word that we made up for ourselves? This is our word. We created it. But you're totally right. And we created it for the purpose of keeping non-white peoples down. And then when folks are like, white person, you're like, wait a minute. How dare you call me the thing that I called myself so I could keep you down? How dare you do that, right? But I mean, it's ridiculous. But it goes to show, right? It goes back to this fragility point. See, we're so used to thinking of race as a black issue or a brown issue, right? That we think, okay, black people have racial identity. Brown people, Latino folks and Asian folks and indigenous folks, they have racial identity. But white people historically have never had to really think about ours. And so once now that whiteness is being interrogated for really the first time in the last, I mean, it's been interrogated by people of color forever, right? But in the mainstream, in the media discourse and political discourse, it's only in the last 15, 20 years that we've started to put whiteness and white privilege and white normativity and hegemony and all these big fancy words like in the middle of the room and said, let's talk about that. The old saying was, I used to think it was James Baldwin, but it wasn't. It was Bob Terry, said, you know, being white means never having to think about it. Now, for a long time, I think that was true. But that's really not true anymore, right? Because white people are actually having to think about, like, what does it mean to be white in a world that's not mostly white and that I now can see is really not mostly white and in a country that's changing and a popular culture that's thoroughly multicultural, right? So a lot has changed that is confronting white people. You know, we may view it as the end of our opportunity or the end of power, all it really is the end of hegemony. It's the end of our hegemonic dominance. Just like Christians are having to get used to like living in a pluralistic world, and some ain't ready, right? And straight folks and cisgendered folks are having to figure out how to actually like share the world openly with LGBTQ folks. And actually we're using terms like transphobia and cisgendered as a word which most people had never even heard of. Many still haven't. Most had not heard of it a few years ago. Think about, I mean, that's pretty transformative at the linguistic level. And it's confronting people who've always taken their normalness, right, for granted. And so if I've never had to think of myself as white, I'm just Tim. I'm just an American. Why can't you be? You know, well, again, because history happened, right? Like, you know, we have to act about things as if history really happened, because it did, and it made a difference. But now, if I'm having to actually confront what my whiteness means, I might not be ready for that. So when you say it, I assume you're saying it judgmentally, although white folks have always talked about black people. And not just in a negative way, but even if you're just referring to somebody, it's like, oh, that black guy over there. Well, you know, and then now, but what you'll notice is sometimes white folks do think we're supposed to like whisper that, right? We do get a little nervous. Like, we're just like, you know, oh, yeah, I was talking to this guy. He's that black guy over there. Which is weird because, like, the black guy totally knows he's black. And you're not keeping a secret from him, right? So, and he doesn't have a problem with being black, you know? It's the one who's whispering that seems to have the problem with it. But I think it just goes to show that, that's what happens when you don't have to confront what your identity means. Historically, when somebody points it out to you, that's when, and it becomes salient to you, and it becomes visible, you get very defensive, you know? And I think that's, you know, all the more evidence of how whiteness has been a privileged space for so long. Because it was only when it was in that sort of uninterrogated space that you didn't have to think about it, and you could just sort of float along on a sea of just being an individual. Whereas people of color have always sort of had to know that their identity was central to their individuality. Like, yes, everybody's, you know, has differences. Not every black person's the same. Not every Asian American's the same. Not every white person's the same. We're all individuals in that regard, even though, like I said earlier, we exist in a social context. But our individuality is shaped, in large part, by our experiences. And I just think, you know, some people, mainly white folks, haven't really had to think about that. One more real quick, and then I promise I'll get out of here. Yeah. Or I'm going to be taken off the stage, one or the other. Go ahead.
Well, I'm short, but okay.
Me too. No shame in that.
So my name is Sandy, and I'm a high school student over in Emporia High, so around this area. And it's been a pleasure listening to your lectures so far. So
thank you.
Thank you. But as an honor, I would like to ask you a question. What advice would you give to a person who is currently a high school student? And what did you do during your high school years?
Well, in my high school years, you know, I was a debater, so I did a lot of that. And which was, you know, I mean, it had something to do maybe with how I ended up going down this path, but only in the sense that, you know, one of the tasks of being a debater is you spend an inordinate amount of time researching stuff that you normally would not at 15, 16, 17 years old, 18 years old. So you become knowledgeable about things that most teenagers maybe normally would not be. And then that sparks an interest perhaps in other things. The actual process of debating itself, in at least in competitive high school policy debate, is not necessarily a real intellectual exercise most of the time. Most of the time it's really not. It's a game. It's a game that we play. And part of the game is you just talk really, really fast. And I was like the worst offender. I mean, I spoke 500 words a minute in debate rounds, and nobody could understand me other than the other debaters and the judge, right? So that part wasn't real helpful, but the research part was. And I think even if one isn't a debater, one can do some of that part that debaters do, right? Which is study, which is research, which is, you know, read stuff that most people maybe your age aren't reading, and really immerse yourself in the wisdom of people who've been involved in this struggle on so many levels for so long. You know, I have a website, timwise.org, with a recommended reading list that has books and blogs and websites where you can find out all kinds of information, some of what I've talked about tonight, but also others who've been doing this work. Lots of great books and websites to check out. So I would say that's number one. Number two is, you know, connect with the people in and around your community who are active on these things. In every community, whether it's this one or whichever ones you might come from, there are communities, there are groups working on everything from educational equity to housing equity to police brutality issues and accountability issues to healthcare reform. There are people working on civil rights and race issues everywhere. So figure out who are those people. Find out some of them may be here in the room. Some of them may be on this campus. There may be, you know, NAACP offices. There may be all kinds of different folks who are doing the work and who need people, maybe as volunteers, maybe to make phone calls, maybe to go knock on doors, maybe to hand out flyers, help plan events. You know, when I got started doing this work, that was the capacity in which I started. Once I was in college, I just started doing work as a campus activist around issues that were of concern at that time. And then I started making connections in the community and then working with nonprofit organizations and just making myself indispensable to them, you know, with whatever skills I had. So that's also important. Figure out what are your skill sets that you think could be of value to social change movements. And we all have different skills. I mean, some people's skill sets are speaking, others are writing, some people are really good with fundraising or even just asking for money. Like, I'm really bad with that piece. So don't ever ask me to raise money for your group or you'll make nothing. But other people are real good with designing flyers and posters and visual arts. Other people are really good with sort of one-on-one interactions, and other people are better in large groups. I mean, there's so many different things that you might be able to do, but you have to be clear about what your skills are and then figure out, you know, who are the folks out there in the community that you can connect with who might need those skills, and how can I use those skills in the service of this thing that I care about. And I think if you do that, in addition to taking advantage of this time in your development as a young person to do that homework, right? Because sometimes we get, and I was certainly one of them, I got very impatient and I felt like I needed to be out doing. And I felt that way when I was 18 and 19 years old and 20 years old. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's a noble impulse. But the problem is sometimes if you start doing and you aren't also researching and learning and growing, it's very dangerous. Like, you can do some harm. And so sometimes it's not about being impatient. It's about taking some time as a young person, taking advantage of the relative freedom that you have as a young person. Relative, because I realize there are young people who are having to work two jobs to help support families and have kids of their own and everything else. But relative to where you will be in 20 years, relative to the real world where you'll have to be doing all kinds of stuff just to survive that you're not having to necessarily do right now, take advantage of that as a time to grow, to develop, to learn, to read, to inquire, to ask questions. And I think if you do those things, you will then begin to see how you can start taking action at a limited level and then build on that and build on that and build on that as you move forward.
Yeah. Am I allowed to ask one more
What's that?
Am I allowed to ask you one more question?
Oh, sure.
Why not? Okay.
Go ahead.
What inspired you to do of what you're doing right now, you know, giving out these public lectures?
I mean, again, it goes back to that early upbringing and I think the imprinting from my family. But really, in terms of long term, because obviously short term, you know, I just sort of had an activist disposition and was concerned about social justice issues early on. But what ultimately was the thing that I would say if there were one thing that pushed me over the edge and got me to commit to this in a longer term sense, you know, I graduated from college in 1990 and at Tulane in New Orleans. And the year that I graduated was the year that David Duke, lifelong white supremacist, neo-Nazi, former Klan leader of the largest Ku Klux Klan group in the United States, ran for the United States Senate. At that point, he had already been elected to the State House in Louisiana, and he was trying to seek higher office. And I was one of the people that was involved in the fight to defeat him, and I was the associate director of the main group that organized against him. He lost that election, although he got 66.0% of the white vote, which is frightening when you think about it, 60% of whites voting for somebody they knew was a Nazi. It wasn't like they didn't know. '91, he decides to run for governor. He loses that one also, but he still gets 54.5% of the white vote. And after that race, I remember, and it wasn't just me, it was my boss and other people that were in the coalition. I remember us all sort of sitting around, both collectively and then on our own, and wondering what this meant, right? What was our path going to be? And keep in mind, at this point, the governor's race is November of 91 is the final vote on that. So I have just turned 23 a month before. And I'm sitting there trying to figure out my direction because I'm 23 and I'm a year out of college, year and a half out of college. I toyed with the idea of going to grad school. I had toyed with the idea of going to law school. I just didn't know what I wanted to do. But as I sat there in that moment, and I tried to put it together, for me at least, as I asked the question, what does this mean for me? I had to grapple with the fact that 55 out of 100 or 60 out of 100 white people, just like me, had voted for a guy that they knew was a Nazi. And I knew that wasn't because they were Nazis. I knew that 6 out of 10 white people, for God's sake, are not Nazis. But they were willing to vote for somebody who was. What did that mean? And what I concluded was I could not be smug about where those people's heads were relative to mine. It would have been easy, though, right? It would have been easy to say, oh, well, they're just stupid racist and I'm more enlightened. But really, the only difference between me and them, other than the part where I'm Jewish and I know not to vote for the Nazi, that helps. But even that was just coincidence, right? Because I just happened to be born and raised Jewish. Like, it didn't have to go that way. It's not like I chose it, you know? I was just raised that way. But other than that piece, the only other difference, really, was that I'd had a certain set of experiences growing up, going to that black preschool, playing ball on black teams, having mostly, you know, a cadre of black friends, going to schools that were 40-45% African-American kids. And they didn't. I had these experiences, they had these experiences. And if I had had theirs, I might be a very different person. And if they had had mine, they would be different people. So I couldn't really judge them as horrible people. I had to struggle with them. And that was when I realized that my job was to grapple with my people, because I was them and they were me, just given slightly different situations. And that's true for every one of us. Every single one of us who thinks that we know something, you know, there was a time we didn't know it. And we have to be humble enough to remember that who we were before we knew what we know. That's why I sort of, you know, I find it interesting, and I did put the thing in the bio you heard at the beginning that I was, you know, according to The Root, one of the 8 wokest white people or whatever the hell that is, you know, that's in the bio. I think it's funny, but it's also sort of interesting, right? Because first of all, it's interesting because they couldn't even find 10 people, apparently. They just found 8 woke white people. Like, normally you round it up, right? You'd be like, let's find a 9th, for God's sake, and a 10th. But they're like, nope, 8, that's it. And I was 8, by the way. I just barely made it in, apparently. I'd like to think it was alphabetical, but I don't think it was. I think I just barely squeezed in. But the other piece is, what does it mean to be woke, right? Woke is a continuum, isn't it? I mean, just like being an ally is a continuum. Ally is a verb, right? Not a noun in that regard. It's what you do, not who you claim to be. And so in that moment, I realized that even though I knew enough not to vote for the Nazi and knew why that was a bad look, that I really wasn't that much more of a decent human being than those 627,000 people who voted for David Duke. I was just a little bit more ahead of the curve on certain issues, but there are other times that I'm sure I'm blind to injustice and don't pay attention to certain things and help contribute to the problem. So part of that for me was that moment of waking up and realizing that has to be my life's work then, because these are my people and I can't keep asking black people to save us. Because in Louisiana, that's what happened. Black people saved us. They had 89% turnout, and they stopped us from electing a Nazi. And there just comes a point for me where I said, you know, we preach a lot of self-help in the white community to black people. And we preach a lot of self-help in the white community to brown people. We preach all kinds of self-help to the other. But in this instance, we need to turn it back on ourselves and apply it to us. And if we do that, and if I do that, you know, maybe we'll get somewhere. So that was my story, and I'm sticking to it. Thank you all so much.
Thank you.
I personally want to thank everyone for coming to our first social justice and equity lecture. We would like to thank the Office of the President, Student Affairs, Student Affairs, we would like to thank them as well. We would like to thank Sodexo. We would like to thank the Department of Leadership Studies. We would like to thank the Department of Sociology. Woohoo! Emporia State Police Department. And the Emporia Police Department as well. So Tim Wise will be in the foyer outside selling and signing books. So if you, oh no, he won't.
I don't have any. Sorry, I'm out. I told you I'm bad about asking for money. Like,
okay, so. Personally, Jason and I would like to just thank each and every one of you for coming out tonight and hearing Tim Wise speak. And to my ESU students, the conversation does not stop here. Like I said, my door is always open. We also have Mosaic going on February 24th and 25th. Registration for Mosaic ends tomorrow. So if you would like to learn more about race and politics and impressions, please sign up to go to Mosaic. So thank you all.